Well, Paul, let me start with asking some questions in your role and capacity of chairman of the AICPA. Can you share with us what some of the greatest accomplishments in your mind were during your tenure as chairman?
Sure. You know, Tim, as you know, the institute is not just about the chairman. It's really about the membership, and we have over 377,000 members, which is a very large organization. Members that are very intelligent, very trustworthy, very filled with integrity, and in all walks of life. They've been very successful in many different ways of life. So when I look back at my year as leader of the profession, I've got some benchmarks, some things that have been done and things that still are in the process of doing. But certainly in the legislative area, we've had a lot going on, whether it be with the IRS, with the registration, the P10 registrations, or whether it be with even some of the rules and regulations that were promulgated by by the Dodd-Frank Act. If you think back to the year 2002, Sarbanes-Oxley was about 68 pages long, and that revolutionized what we did within the profession and in business. Well, Dodd-Frank is 2,319 pages long, and we haven't seen the impact of that. So we worked hard during this past year making sure that we were focused on that, making sure that the profession understood, as well as business understood, what was in that act. And we were very instrumental down in Washington to help avoid some of the things, the pitfalls that we could have been, as a profession, been pulled into. So that was one of the other areas. You know, on the Patent Reform Act, we've been working on that for 5 years, where it would have been that any idea for a patent calculation for a calculation within the tax code could have been patented. That was just a bad law. We worked on that, and actually I got to see the signing by the president, so it was kind of an exciting thing. So that was kind of on the legislative front. But if you look, it's much more than just the legislative areas. Certainly with FASB, with the SEC, we interact significantly. We interact with the AISB, the International Standards Board. We've had many positive results coming out of those discussions. We've had summit meetings with many international organizations, Canada, Mexico. I was just in South Africa last week, dealing with international issues. But I guess if I had to pin it down to maybe three or four major items, I would say certainly we just announced a joint venture with an organization over in London called CIMA. That's a Chartered Institute of Management Accountants. And CIMA is an organization with 177,000 members. So we joined them together. My board and my council approved us joining together, and that'll happen in January. And the relevance of that is we'll have 550,000 members strong with this joint venture, our 377,000 and approximately 170,000 of CIMA members. And that'll provide a platform for our members in industry. We have about 140,000 members that work in industry. I'm the second chair from industry out of 124 years that the AICPA has been around. Most of the chairs come from public accounting. We had one from government, and now I'm the second from industry. So that was important to me to make sure this connection is solidified. But even beyond that, it's really the international connection. CIMA is a body that is in 29 separate countries. Those countries are throughout the world, and we will now be teamed up with them and partner with them. So that's one of the areas. And I think long term for the profession, that's going to put us on the map globally, which is something we've actually recently become very aware that certainly we're a very global economic enterprise. We need that correspondence back and forth. That's one of the areas. The second area is that I'm pretty proud of is about 15 years ago we embarked upon a visioning process for the profession. And it was back in 1996 through 98 that ultimately we finished it up in 1999. And we created a vision for the profession. And we defined the core purpose, the core values, the core competencies of what the profession was like and what it should be for the next 15 years. No other profession had looked at that, going out that long. A lot of professions have done strategic plans for 3 or 5 years, but we actually went out and we did a project that was called Vision 2011 and Beyond. Well, here it was 2011 and I became chair. So I said, it's time to refresh that vision. And let's look and see if our core purpose and our core values and the core competencies will last us another 15 years and beyond. So we call it Horizons 2025. And what we did was we actually went out to our members and we got over 75,000 comments through the use of technology. And we refreshed that vision process. And we defined, we went back and we said, is our core purpose correct? And the core purpose back 15 years ago was making sense of a complex and changing world. Well, that was true then, but it's ever so true today. And so we said, no, that core mission, that core purpose, and the core definition of a CPA is still true. But then what we did was we also looked at the core values. And the core values is, again, something that hasn't changed a lot, although it's expanded a little. It's integrity, it's objectivity, it's attuned to broad business decisions, it's making sure that we're competent, it's making sure that we're now in tune with the broad global issues. Mm-hmm. And that's where it's expanded a little. But our core values of integrity, objectivity, and certainly lifelong learning are still valid today. What's changed a little is the competencies. And I think this is important for university students, because the world has evolved, and the services that we provide are no longer just traditional services. They're expanded services. We have, as I said before, we've got 140,000 members in industry. And those members are, they may be controllers, or they may be HR people, or they may be presidents. I'm president and CEO. I was president and CEO of a bank. I'm regional president of a bank right now. That's my real job. But it prepared me, having those core values and the core competencies prepared me for my lifelong learning going out into the future. Well, this Horizons 2025 project defined that, you know, it's not just the competencies of understanding, you know, the technical issues. It goes beyond that. It's the soft skills. It's the negotiation skills. It's being able to synthesize factual information into intelligent decisions. It's being able to problem solve. And it's something that this project into the future will be something that will be relied upon for universities to define what our competencies need to be and what we need to be training those. So it was really a great, great dive down into our membership. And it was a process where we surveyed over 5,500 of our members. And we met with regulators, we met with businessmen, we met with futurists, and trying to define what the demographics would be like in the future. So that was kind of the second major item. And I think the third major item is private company financial reporting. And I'm pretty proud that we've moved that along pretty far. We haven't come up to the final decisions yet, the FAF. The FAF is the Financial Accounting Foundation. That's the parent company of the FASB and GASB. You've got FAF up here. They came up with a blue ribbon panel recommendation this past year and decided that there should be differential standards, which is something we've been working on actually since I was in school in the early 70s when the FASB was first promulgating rules. There was a discussion back then whether or not there should be private company financial reporting standards and public company financial reporting standards. We have 15,000 companies in this country that are public, and we've got 29.5 million companies that are private, but they all follow the same rules. Well, some of it is not relevant to the user and not relevant to the preparer, nor relevant to the company themselves. Mm-hmm. So that's one of the things. So in a nutshell, I think, you know, we've got the normal every year, the legislative items, the reporting items, But the three hallmarks certainly are going to be the CGMA, the Chartered Global Management Accountant, the Horizons 2025 project, and private company financial reporting, because I'm sure we're going to come up with a resolution very shortly.